step out now, because I got on my wake-up pants. I got these this morning. My wife said, are you going to wear them pants? Yeah, I'm going to wear these pants. So, this is my wake-up pants. Now, I'm already in trouble. Because I done said something about my wife. But I'm glad to see you this morning. It's good to be here. We went to a class reunion last night. Her class reunion. She had a really good time. So if she goes to sleep, please ignore that. But I woke her up this morning before she was ready. Yesterday was her birthday, so she's a year older. I'm just getting deeper and deeper, aren't I?
You're
eating
yourself up.
Maybe I better rush. Say again, good morning, and hope that you have planned to be here Saturday night, this coming Saturday night, because there will be, I have heard already this morning, homemade ice cream. Now, the preliminaries leading up to the homemade ice cream will promise us to be just as good as the homemade ice cream, because that's when the picking and the grinding and all the almost said carrying on. That wouldn't be the right word, would it? Well, just plan to be here and see what happens. There you go. That'll work. Any announcements you have this morning?
Well, I want to say thank you to everybody for your prayers, your cards, your phone calls for Bobby. He's still got a way to go. You know, he's still limited to a certain degree. But he is so much better, thank to the Lord. Great. Jesus.
Good. That's wonderful.
Hey, I could leave him.
That didn't sound right.
For just a little bit.
Okay, yeah, that's good. That's good.
I would like to encourage everybody when they come to the picking and greening to bring a, if they don't bring homemade ice cream, to bring some sandwiches or cookies or bigger foods. We'll need all the help we can get to feed that crowd.
It's getting better all the time. Now we've gone from homemade ice cream to sandwiches. Oh, yeah, this is getting better all the time. Has to be somebody throw a wrench in it. Don't forget to play. Anything else you'd like to share this morning? Good to see you sitting back over there. It'd be better if I could hear you picking, but we'll wait.
And I want to thank everybody too for prayer and well wishes.
We're glad you're back. Anything else you'd like to share? Let's pray. Father, thank you this morning for these that are here, the homes that are represented, the prayers that they offer to you and the prayers they offer for their church and for each other. Thank you for the love they share with each other and with others, with their families, with their friends, for the concerns that they have for each other. Shows them their love. Shows them their love for you also. Forgive us this morning, we ask, of the sins that we have committed. Forgive us for the times we have not done all we know we should have done. And the times when we've spoken out when we should have remained silent. Forgive us, Lord, that we've been able to look and see those in need and turn away. Forgive us that we have sinned. Thank you, Father, for today, for the healing that's taking place in these in our congregation who are sick. And thank you for the knowledge that you give to doctors and nurses to care for us when we're sick. Thank you for giving them the ability to set up a process that our bodies can heal themselves. Continue to be with us. Continue to bless us. Continue to use us And as we look forward to the time together that's coming up this next weekend, Lord, may it be a blessing to everyone. May our church be a blessing to all who will come this way. Lord, bless this church. Use this church. As you use the church across the street, the church down the road. Bless these churches in this community and throughout the world. Use us, we pray, in whatever way you see fit to use us. Father, thank you this morning. We lift up to you the leaders of our nation, the leaders of our state and our community, the leaders of the church. We lift up to you again the doctors and the nurses, the policemen, the firemen, the teachers, all who make our lives better. And again, we ask the blessing upon us, upon this church, and upon these from our congregation who can't be with us today. Just be with them, comfort those who are sick. Give strength to those who need it and wisdom to those who lack. These things we pray and ask in the name of the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Let's worship together with hymn number 369.
You have blessed us And so we seek to bless others by what we give back to the church, for the work of the church, this church and other churches. May what we give back be pleasing to you. May you multiply it and use it. Whatever way you see fit, we ask it in Jesus' name.
Oh,
proclamation of faith this morning is number 882 in your bulletin, in your hymnal, excuse me. It is the Apostles' Creed, but it is the ecumenical version. Page number 882 in your hymnal. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I thought about a little earlier, I shared with you last week that trying to get into the 21st century a little bit using this iPad and have a couple of different versions of the Bible on it and some other things, sermon on it. I realized why I like this thing this morning. It took me till this morning. Now, I got this iPad back in February, and I realized this morning why I like it. It's because when you close it up and you don't do anything with it, you just let it sit, it goes to sleep, which is just like me. One other thing that I want to share, and I should have shared with you earlier, and I apologize that I didn't. Another thing about getting, I guess, into the, I don't know if it's getting into the 20th century, 21st century or what, but our phone number on the back of the bulletin, if you take a look at that, our phone number is on here is 256-492-1745. That phone number is about to go away. And the new phone number will be 256-312-1145. I'm going to catch all kind of grief at my house for it, but I'm doing away with house phones. Everybody at my house got a cell phone. I said, no reason to have two different sets of phones. I'm going to catch grief for that at my house. 312-1145. Our scripture lesson this morning is taken from the Gospel according to Mark. And it's a story that I'm sure that most of you are familiar with. It's the story of Jesus causing a storm to stop. Jesus still in the storm. It's from Mark's Gospel, the third beginning, it's in the fourth chapter, beginning with the 35th verse and reading through the end of the chapter, verse 41. And on that day, when evening had come, he said to them, let's go across to the other side. Leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Now, I'm not sure exactly what that means, just as he was. But they took him with them, just as he was, in the boat. And there were other boats with them. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. Now, you know what that means. The waves were coming into the boat. It was beginning to get filled with water. But Jesus was in the stern, and it says he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, teacher, do you not care that we're perishing? Or in other words, hey, we're about to drown. We're about to sink. Do something. Do you not care that we're perishing? He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. And then the wind ceased and there was a dead calm. said to them, "Why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?" The word of God, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Oh,
scripture passage. Early in his gospel, which would lead us to believe that it's early in Jesus' ministry and the disciples have not seen yet all of the miracles that Jesus will do in their sight. And so perhaps they don't know why they need him awake, except that maybe they're afraid he'll drown. Because, or maybe they just think, well, let's wake him up and see. Something's got to happen. You know, it would be kind of like your storm's coming and you're just sleeping on through it and the rest of the family's up and, you know, they come wake you up. Hey, it's coming, a storm, don't you care? You go and get up and say, well, what do you want me to do about it? I can't stop it. But in this case, you see, Jesus could stop it. And they're amazed that he stops it. The pediatric nurse had the hard task of giving immunization shots to children. One patient, a 4-year-old, refused to let her give her a shot. She stared at the needle and clung to her mother and said, no. I can understand that. The mother said, now, darling, that's not polite behavior. So the little girl changed her tune. No, thank you, no, thank you, no, thank you. You know, life can be hard. I'm sure you know that. I'm not telling you anything you don't know there. And we try to trust God with our problems, but sometimes the problems mount. The waves are just coming over the sides. The waves are coming over the boat, and it seems like the boat is going to sink in spite of everything. And we want to cry out, no, 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 no. But we think to ourselves, well, that's not polite to do that, not polite behavior. So we ourselves cry out, no thank you, no thank you, no thank you. One of the most familiar scenes in Scripture, this story that we've shared this morning. They're in a boat. It's getting dark. It's gone to lake. Great windstorm comes up. That part of the world over there, they have windstorms that come up across the Sea of Galilee just like that. Drop of a hat, you can't see it coming, bang, it's on you. What are you going to do? The waves are beating the boat. The boat's beginning to take on water. The boat's being swamped. And Jesus is asleep up in the front of the boat. They wake him up and they ask him a question. Do you not care that we're about to drown? Do you not care that we're about to sink? Do you not care that we're about to die, that we're perishing? Do you not care? The little girl and her mother stood in line in front of a gas chamber at the Belzec concentration camp during World War II. The little girl didn't understand the fate that was about to befall her, but she could see the agony on the faces of those around her, and she tugged on her mother's sleeve, and she said, Mama, Mama, it's dark in there, and I've been a good girl. Why are we going in there? I've been a good girl. Why are we going in there? She didn't understand why she and her mother and all these other good people were being hurt. Where was God? And often on a much smaller scale, we feel like that little girl. Life doesn't work out like we think it should. Storm clouds gather. Our little boat is being swamped and we're on the verge of surrender. Teacher, said the disciples, do you not care that we are perishing? Sometimes we find ourselves in the middle of a terrible storm. There are few families or individuals who go through life untouched by some kind of a tragedy. I had a fellow, one of the laymen in another church that we pastored years ago, who said, if something bad hadn't happened to you, get ready, because it's going to. Something is going to happen to everybody. Tragedy, we discover that we are inadequate to handle by ourselves. We're like a little boy who likes to play Superman. Each morning, he's 3 years old, and each morning he gets up out of bed and he asks his mother to pin a towel to his little t-shirt. Each morning, his mother obliges him and pins a towel to his t-shirt. And immediately when that towel is pinned to him, his imaginative mind moves him and changes that towel into a brilliant blue and red cape, and he becomes Superman. And so all day, his day is packed with adventure and daring escapades. In his mind, he not only is playing Superman, he is Superman. Fact becomes clearly pointed out when his mother takes him down to enroll him in kindergarten. During the course of the interview, the teacher looks at the little Ray and says, "What's your name?" "Superman," he answers politely and without pause. Teacher smiles, casts an appreciative glance at his mother, and then asks again, "Your real name, please?" Again he answers, "Superman." Realizing the situation demands more authority or maybe to hide her own amusement, the teacher closes her eyes for a moment. And then in a stern a voice as she can muster, she said, "I will have to have your real name for the records." Now little Ray sees that he's got to play it straight with the teacher, so he turns his eyes, slides his eyes all around the room, gets over closer to the teacher, and says to her, "Clark Kent." You know, through most of our lives, we can just stride confidently through life as if we are Superman or Superwoman, but then the wind starts blowing and the boat starts rocking, and we have to confess that we're not Superman, we're just Clark Kent in disguise. And so what do? Well, if we're wise in it at all, we turn to God. When we are inadequate to deal with life pressures, when we are confronted with the trials and the troubles of life, then we can be comforted by the promise that God is with us. But sometimes when we turn to God, there's a silence. You know, we come to God with our problems and there's a silence there. Sometimes it's a chilling silence. Sometimes we're like those disciples in the boat who found the master sleeping during their distress, and we wonder, is God asleep? Does God hear me? Are my prayers getting out of the attic? Some unknown poet's given a new twist to an old saying. Primarily it's aimed at husbands and wives, but I think it's appropriate to our relationship with God. Sticks and stones are hard on bones, aimed with an angry arc. Words can sting like anything, but silence breaks the heart. Silence does break the heart, particularly when it's God's silence, when we cry out to God and we hear nothing back. But could it be that God speaks even in the silence? Could it be that it was necessary for Jesus to sleep in the front of that boat so that the disciples would be confronted with the inadequacy of their little faith? Could it be that they needed to learn a lesson? Could it be that sometimes we need to learn a lesson? A man named James DeBello was raised a devout Roman Catholic. His earliest memories, he said, was of the prayers his mother taught him. And he said his mother even set a place at the dinner table every day in honor of their guardian angel. But James had a younger brother who died of leukemia when he was young. And when his younger brother died of leukemia, James turned his back on the faith. Where was God in that, that let his little brother die? And he began to channel all of his negative emotions into overachieving at school and overachieving in sports, and after he got out of school, he married and started his family. He focused all of his attentions on his work. It came as a big surprise the day his wife said, "I'm leaving you." You don't focus somewhere else, "I'm leaving." And all the anger that he had bottled up inside of him over the years began to pour out, and he began grabbing things out of the cabinet and slinging things and breaking things, and he's breaking all the dishes that they had. He got down to the last dish, and a voice said to him, "Make room for me at the table." He hesitated. "Make room for me at the table." And he instantly remembered how his mother used to set a place each evening for what she termed their guardian angel. So he laid out the last plate, and he put a napkin, and he put utensils, and he invited the angel to come and sit down, and he bowed his head and began to pray. And then he began talking aloud as if his angel were sitting next to him, and he confessed all of his grief and all of his fears and all of his failures. And after that day, he reconciled with his wife. And he quit the job that he had. He began a new job that allowed him more time with his family. And every night, he and his wife set a place for their guardian angel at the table. Now, the idea of setting a place for a guardian angel may not fit your understanding of the universe. I'm not advocating you go home and do that. But the idea that God may be speaking to us even in the silence be important to us, because that time of silence can be a time of self-examination. It can be a time of reflecting on those things that are most important to us. It can be a time of our surrendering to God's amazing love. In fear, the disciples asked Jesus, "Teacher, do you not care that we're perishing?" And you know what happened next. We shared the text with you. Jesus wakes up and says to the wind, "Quiet, be still." And just, it stopped. Now, I can just close my eyes and picture these disciples looking at each other and going, "What just happened? Did that wind just stop? Did those waves just stop? What happened here? What happened?" And he looked at the disciples, and he said to them, "Why are you afraid? And if any of them had been like me or my granddaughter, they'd have said, 'Because we were about to drown.'" And then he said, "Have you still no faith?" You see, the problem was not the storm outside. The problem was the fear, the storm within. The fear within. A fear that could have been dispelled if they had come to grips with their doubts. And often that's the case with us as well. The storms rage around us. We cry out. Sometimes it seems like God's asleep. God doesn't hear us now. Maybe our prayers are not getting there. We cry out louder. It still seems like God doesn't hear us. And we cry out more. And we cry out more often. And we cry out louder. And in the silence, we wrestle. We wrestle with that problem. We wrestle with all that is important to us. And then all of a sudden, everything is still. Because God does calm the storm in our hearts. And later in our life, we can look back. And like the disciples, we marvel at what God has done. And even though we thought God was sleeping, God was at work. Because God surrounds us with people who care. So often in the church, I hear people say, some people in our church who helped me get through the storm. It's one of the things that I love the most about a small membership church. Everybody knows each other, and you're a family, and you help each other, and you care for each other, and you love each other, and you pray for each other. It's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing. How comforting it was to realize how many people are praying for us. How comforting it is to know that there are people who love you and are praying for you. The storms rage and we cry out, and later we discover God was at work even though we thought he was asleep. He was at work through the other members of our congregation. He was at work through the other people that we know. Sometimes we experience something beautiful. Sometimes we experience something so amazing that we later term it a miracle. Later, sometimes we find strength for the journey. We don't always end where we want it to end, but we find strength for the journey through the love and the prayers and the support of family and friends. In some way, miraculously, we discover that God gives us a peaceful acceptance of a painful situation. Took part in a funeral this past Monday for a dear friend who had suffered and struggled and gone through this. His family had been with him through it all. He was able to go to meet the Lord at home. But in all of that, you see how God gives the strength. It was an hour-long service, the funeral was. And there were little tears, but there were a lot of laughter to celebrate his life because of the strength that God had given. And sooner or later, we discover when the storm rages that God does indeed care. Now the grueling experience, we come out more mature in our faith. And we become like those fearful disciples that Mark tells us about. And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" It's God. Does God care? Yes, God cares. When it hurts, God cries with me, with you. And I think that says it all. That God cares. Even when God is silent, God is at work. Trust God. God can still the storms that fill our lives. And you still know faith. Trust God. His presence.
place, to go into a world filled with storms, go fearlessly in the love of Jesus. Amen.
Good to see you again.
Good to see you again.
Yes.